Hello again, everyone. Melth here, with more of my Baldur's Gate 3 challenge run. Last time I cleared out the entire Myconid colony in a pretty epic battle. This time I'm going to Grimforge to take the fight to the Dwargar slavers there. Watch out for spoilers throughout this run. Alright, so here we are over near where Gek Kol's boat is left. We killed him like 20 episodes ago, and we'll now be going across the underground lake here. Now, getting to this boat does count as traveling to a different region for some purposes. For example, my hex spell that I'm concentrating on will just automatically end. Honestly, I cannot find any documentation or any pattern whatsoever to what things do and don't end when you travel in different ways. Like, this boat here will end your concentration on things, but it will not, for example, heal you, like going to the mountain pass for the first time will. Again, there's no pattern I can find. It seems very arbitrary which travel methods and which circumstances give you back or take away different things from you. It's fine, it's just, you know, it's important to know, and there's no way to know ahead of time that I'm aware of. Anyway, I like this scene quite a lot. I enjoy caves, and especially underground lakes. I had a chance to go on an underground lake boat tour once myself, which is pretty neat. So, I wish if anything there was more content here on this lake, maybe more destinations we can get to, or maybe more encounters on the surface of the lake itself. But just this one is still very good. I do wonder, you know, how do we sail, given that there shouldn't be any wind in this cave from what we're, you know, seeing about it. But, you know, everything in the Underdark has to be exactly the same as the surface world, basically. So, of course, there's sailing ships in the Underdark. That's not an issue with this game, that's just kind of a, you know, a Forgotten Realms thing of making the Underdark be the exact same as the surface in every way, pretty much.
I aren't expecting more of you. Where's Gek? Who are you?
I really enjoy this scene here in our options. It's just hilarious to just push him off into the water and have him just, you know, instantly die somehow or other that way. But I think I better not do that for my challenge run, because of course I want to fight things in the hardest way rather than by just instant killing one guy in conversation before the battle begins. So the question though is, what is the hardest approach here? See, there's two options. I can either fight Corsair Greyman with his crew here, and they're a decently challenging fight. Or can cooperate with him, in which case his crew is never seen again and never fought, but Corsair Greyman himself will show up as a moderately dangerous enemy in the really big fight in Grimforge. I think overall, this fight is more difficult than just adding him to that one battle when he's just like one guy among 20 or whatever adds the difficulty. So this is probably the hardest thing overall to do to resolve this one with combat, so I'll do that.
Get him, fellas.
It's an interesting encounter anyway, and I quite enjoy it. Let's talk about our enemies here. So the most dangerous enemy of all is the water itself. Falling to that, it's instant death for us or them. I find that a little bit peculiar because, like, it isn't that deep, given we see these numerous stalagmites here, and we're not moving that fast and whatnot anyway, but instant death. The Dwarves themselves are no slouches either. For one thing, they have massive hit point pools. Like, we have basically reached the limits of Astarion's abilities. He just cannot kill more than one of these guys per turn. On his own, really. They're too sturdy. Even with their mediocre armor classes, they're just too tough. That's gonna be a whole thing throughout Grimforge, really. Now, in terms of what their offensive capabilities are, all the crossbow ones have moderately powerful attacks, have extra attack, and shoot fire arrows, which is pretty dangerous if you let them hit you. The Mind Master there is a real threat, because he can mind control your guys to attack each other if you fail the will saving throw, so that's pretty bad. And then, you know, these two are basically just melee fighters. Moderately dangerous because they can push you off to your death, but not as bad as maybe some of the other things I was talking about. Oh, and the Alchemist over here throws smoke powder bombs, so that's pretty painful. In any case. Oh, good. This Raven actually went pretty fast here, so that's nice. If it loses initiative, I don't really know of a way to save it because it just kind of stuck over here, so I think we just had to die. Let's hit this guy and blind him if we can. We can't. Okay. I don't want to push him overboard, because I really want to get his treasure, because he's the shopkeeper and therefore has some pretty good stuff. Okay. So that baned him and also gave him reverberation, thereby making him substantially weaker to a halo of spores. He might still resist it, but yeah, better chance now. Okay, that was almost minimum damage, but every little bit counts, right? So let's go up here and then shoot a crossbow at the guy. not bad. And then I think for this fight, we're still fine using the returning pike. We really don't care about defense here. I mean, we do, but I'll explain why I have another countermeasure for that, basically, so I don't care about having good armor class. So I'll throw the returning pike at him for maximum damage, compared to my usual throwing weapons. Yeah, that's not bad. Okay. So if you now shoot him, you will almost certainly leave him alive, but at low HP. Let me actually make sure of one other thing. I want to remember to turn off dual wielding, but they don't let you do that unless you are at risk of it hurting you for some silly reason. So, we'll shoot at him, leaving him injured but alive. Nice, that was pretty much perfect, in fact. Well, in that case, can I actually take him out with a bonus action shot from Ballista? Probably. Nice. Okay. So now I can use my pushing ability to just knock people off to their deaths if I want to. Do I want to? I want to kill that guy so I can loot his smoke powder bomb, I think. That one I'm fine with knocking overboard. That one doesn't matter that much. I plan to use an arrow of darkness to cover all my guys, basically, so they can't do anything to me. But the fire arrow guys can still be at least a moderate threat. Although, if I don't let them shoot fire arrows at all, then I can, you know, get their arrows for myself, I guess. So, how do I want to go about this? I guess I'm going to live dangerously, I'm going to not push them off the cliff to their death. So this guy is the next big threat, I would say.
You're mine.
We need to make sure that Astarion gets a kill at some point here.
Despite everything.
Now is a fine time, I guess, so I will... Come on, there must be a towel. It's okay, not a towel, a pixel. Okay, there we go.
Let's turn someone inside out.
Alright, so this should kill if it hits. Which did, very good. The Mind Master will not be a threat if I put up a Cloud of Darkness, which is what I plan to do. And you aren't a big deal, because you're just kind of a melee person. So really, I think I wanted to just take out one of the archers so I can then guarantee loot their arrows, if at all possible. Nice. And one more.
Nothing important is ever easy.
I think I'm almost guaranteed with lightning charges and whatnot to just kill this guy off if I shoot him. So I think I'll just go ahead and do that. Oh, you know, I do have a chance of missing him due to a... low ground. Maybe I'll walk over here first to get rid of that penalty. Okay. That should almost guaranteed kill. There a pixel hits that guy? There is. I'll go for that one then.
Done.
Okay. So now it's just a matter of getting people into a cloud of darkness and making it so they can't actually get a fire out of shoot at any of us. So let's pass an arrow of darkness over to Korolak. Then have her shoot it over... That should be fine, I think. And she can walk right into it there, I guess. And Astarion can walk... You know, we want them all to be fairly deep into it so the enemy can't just... shoot at the fringes with an AoE blast and hit them that way. Especially the ravens are vulnerable to that kind of cheap shot, so we don't want that for them.
Fury. I am dead.
And Lazelle's over here, so she can't really get into it, but she can take cover behind it where they can't actually hit her, because they can't shoot through it either.
They're dying for me. All of them.
And you... get on in there. Alright, I think we should be good with that. We'll see. Maybe I missed like a pixel they can shoot at. Nope. Covered properly. Nice. Okay, well how much movement would it take for me to get over to there? It'd take about 2/3, it looks like. That's a lot. See, I think I could fly out there and peck the guy and then get back into the cloud. But I'm not guaranteed to be able to do so. It might be that I won't have quite enough to get back here. I think I'm going to try it, at least. Even if I fail to blind him, and it needs to be that guy, because he's the one that won't have a turn before I can take advantage of the blind, because it only lasts until the start of their turn. Anyway, even if I can't blind him, he has a crossbow, so he can't attack me as I flee. So. Alright, so the Mind Master should be blocked too. Yeah, great. Waste your actions dashing by all means. Oh, dashing to low ground. I appreciate that too. I'm surprised that guy didn't actually come over here, but that's fine. He's kind of the next threat, because if he gets over here, he can attack us with melee attacks in the darkness, so we'd better just dispose of him next, I think. It says death there, that means the pike would die somewhere other. We can't have that happening. We need to find a picture like that where it won't fall overboard. I think it would return anyway, but it apparently won't always, so. That was some bad damage. Do watch out for Dwarger shoving you. I think that's really worth bearing in mind as one of their key tricks. They can turn invisible, they can enlarge themselves, and they can shove you really well while they're enlarged, because it gives them advantage on athletics checks, and so they can have a good chance to push you into the instant death water, or into the not instant death lava. Somehow the lava is substantially less dangerous than the water. Right. Well, I should probably try to blind that guy, come to think of it. In fact, I should have done that before, but... Well... Can't find path, it's right there. Okay. So...
I've missed this.
We probably want to have Bolasig out of the way. We want, again, to get both Ballista and Asari an extra turn by giving them each a kill. Which is not easy, but should be doable. You still have 50 HP, which is a lot of HP. I wonder about getting you out of there so I can shoot like a fire arrow or something like that. Looks like I don't have enough movement speed to do what I was thinking I'd like to. But I could at least shoot a fire arrow at the guy or something like that now. Okay. 21 HP.
What now?
If you attack, you're likely to do about 16 damage, plus you activate your lightning charges for a little bit. Well, no, that doesn't apply to this hit. That applies on the next hit. Hmm.
Hungry for the slaughter.
If you just attack now, you're almost guaranteed to get the kill. Maybe we should just go for that. Okay, you've got your extra attack. Bye. Can you maybe soften that guy up so that Ballista can get the kill? Perhaps we can do it that way. Well, kind of good, I guess. As long as we can still manage this.
Time to strike.
He's not actually blind. He is an acid, or he was. Now he's suddenly not, is he? That is so strange how that happens sometimes. Yeah, the acid went away. I guess the guy bled and that's why it went away? Okay, that might be a bit of an issue.
It's hot in here.
Still on my feet.
I don't know if I have enough actions wanting to take the guy down now. You've got that for a little bit of damage, but not much. You can't get to safety. I could have a shovel get in there and try to frighten the guy or something. He does have Baneful Strike, making him a little bit weaker at will saves, but he's still, like, you know, dangerously good, I'd say. Still, I think that's probably got to be the play. Didn't work, but it does at least hopefully occupy him. I'd rather he go for these familiars than any of the more important targets that aren't easily replaced, I guess.
Karlak. It's go time.
On my way.
Well, as you might expect from a mind master, he's not really an attack fiend. If we stay in the darkness, he can maybe take out a familiar or something like that, but he won't be a great warrior like the guys we're taking down would have been. We should be okay on that front, I think. Okay, he's spending his action just reducing himself instead because he's not a good fighter. So, yeah, we're good. Alright, that got a little bit complicated, but we're good. If I just pushed them overboard, this would have been over in seconds, but... Okay. Well, let's have just Ballista go around and loot things for simplicity's sake, I think. So, Corsair Grayman over here has the real prizes. Jorgul's Greatsword is pretty unimpressive. It sounds cool, but it's basically the +1 Greatsword that also once per short rest lets you do this, because, you know, that's a weapon action, which is therefore only once per short rest, which doesn't really make a difference in my run where I can't short rest at all. Well, almost never, that is. So, I don't care about that, it just goes into the wares. Shining Saber of Skulls seems like it'll be good, because it's basically a light hammer, therefore a throwable weapon, that's +1, so that sounds like just kind of better than the Skybreaker. And it also does +D4 radiant damage, right? With the also kind of positive and negative of providing light all the time. Well, kind of, but also kind of no. Because throwable weapons basically never apply their abilities, so it won't do that radiant damage. It just doesn't happen. So it's not really any better than Skybreaker. I guess we'll take it, you know, might as well have it. We want to apply light to the enemy as well as hitting it at the same time. I guess it's good for that, but it's nothing too special. The Bow of the Banshee is kind of special, I would say. It's not amazing by any means, but you can actually, you know, get some mileage out of its blood-curdling emission ability. If you have the ability to make a lot of attacks, you can inflict a lot of attempts of frighten on people. And it's important to note that in 5e, although many different things will all say they inflict frightened, which does sound like it would do the same thing, it really doesn't. Frightened does always mean you have a penalty to your attack rolls and whatnot, but sometimes it means you have to stand still, sometimes it means you have to run away, sometimes no effect on your movement whatsoever. Every frightened is different. This one actually debilitates their movement, so that's pretty good as a control effect. Just, you know, at range, stop them from moving whatsoever as long as they fail a saving throw. That's decent. You can definitely build around that and get some mileage out of it, plus the hit bonus is nice too. So, I do think that does have some value. I won't use it for my run, I don't think, normally, but I might at least keep it around in case I see an opportunity to get some uses out of it. Make sure not to misclick and fall into the water to instantly die. As I said, the Mind Master basically just has trash. But the Alchemist has a bomb that we want, and some other throwables too, I guess. Comfort. Well, that's okay. She'll get to loot some fire arrows off these people, because I went to the trouble of killing them rather than shoving them overboard. As usual, only loot things that are worth about a 10 to 1 ratio, roughly. Of, you know, gold value to weight, which heavy crosses don't meet. If I was going to sell things at a merchant immediately, which I guess I could take them around for that reason, but it feels like bad roleplaying to do so if they are barely worth anything. This is another neat weapon. I probably won't use it much because melee is bad, but like, you can actually get some mileage out of this one. Being able to, you know, if you can critical a lot, which there are many ways to allow yourself to do, or you can kill targets a lot, which is also quite possible to do, an AoE prone effect that you can apply many times is decent. You know, they can have a chance to resist it, but it's decent as a control ability. So, I value control a lot. As I've said before, there's really only two valid combat roles in 5e and in Baldur's Gate 3. You know, you're either doing control, or you're doing damage. Nothing else is useful. This does decent control while also kind of doing, you know, normal weapon damage. So, that's something. Alright, let me offload some things here. Okay, well, with that done, I can have Shovel hide again. And we can get back to sailing our ship along to Grimforge.
Craft is ready to sail.
Another cool moment there, just sailing into the darkness. And I like the scenery when we arrive, too. I really like this establishing shot here. You know, helps inspire you with the idea that this is a really grand place. I do find it a little bit odd how the lava on the right side is very sluggish but also splashy at the same time, but yeah, who cares really. It's a neat scene. Statues of Shar there. Thank goodness we got rid of that traitorous Shar worshipper. Wouldn't want to bring her to the Shar temple and to the Shar cursed lands beyond it. Not when her goal was to take away the artifact that made us defend ourselves and take it away to Shar's temple.
Women are ready, lass. Company's calling.
This is almost like the last sentence in the people that will be without an expletive or vulgarity.
What do we got here?
I guess it's kind of their
dead
thing.
Coon walking, seems like. Got any reason I shouldn't sever your head and toss it to the Rothe?
Another belligerent dwarf? This is getting tiresome.
We'll see about...
So they don't actually have parasites, but as I think I mentioned a few episodes ago, Dwergar have psionic powers, because again and again and again, the Mind Flayers are slave race like the Dwergar, and then are surprised when they get psionic powers in a revolt. It happened like 5 times, and the Mind Flayers never learn their lesson somehow.
In that case, let's talk business. Your twat's old friend Nair caused a rockfall.
So I do like the plot twist here that these Dwergar are not actually in league with the Absolute. I mean, they're cooperating with them, but they actually have a reason to dislike them too. It's interesting, it sets up for cool dynamics and, you know, quest options here. So, good design, I think.
Make a donation.
I do find it odd that she's drawing a knife on you when you could probably kill her where she stands, when she's just kind of bluffing anyway. Now, we're here to rescue the slaves, so he might actually just go ahead and ask this to see if he can get some information.
Mostly. Easy to feed. Fat thumbs for digging.
That's a problem for you.
Hoping to get information, we really didn't get it there. But I guess he's looking around and probably seeing that there's no, you know, reinforcements in sight. Might just want to kill these people now, who've been threatening us anyway, rather than have them sound the alarm and gather up defenders. That won't actually happen, of course, but it just kind of makes roleplay sense, I think. Plus, also, in terms of challenge, like, there's no other time to get them grouped up with anyone else. They might as well just fight them here, as far as I can tell.
You'll work through it, Jarg.
Lazelle is pro-slavery, adamantly pro-slavery, because the Gith are a slaver race, and that's all they do. Asarion is often pro-slavery, too, because he's, you know, horrible and lacks empathy for anyone.
Choke the life out of you, shit for brains!
Well, these are once again some darn sturdy dwarves. He has better armor class than the guys on the boat, and better hit points too. And she's got really good armor class, and also has quite respectable hit points, so it is no mean feat taking them out. Let's see if we can blind her. It'll be really valuable if we can, you know, get around that high armor class that way. Nice. Okay, that'll help everyone else. I had 2 more ravens to attempt it with. It's great to just have tons of ravens, because even with a 35% blind chance, when you have 3 guys going at it, that's suddenly actually a pretty good chance, you know? Having lots of raven familiars is really, really valuable for just having advantage whenever you want it.
Survival is all that matters.
Okay, well, now that we have that making things easier for us, how about you? You know, who's gonna be weaker to constitution? You're pretty weak to constitution saving throws. You're pretty strong against them, so we probably want to weaken Morgul here and then apply Lazelle's attack next. But we might actually get some value out of firing off our Dread Ambusher ranged first to lower the guy's armor class a little bit more by applying that -1 dexterity. If the person's wearing heavy armor, that doesn't apply anyway, but if it's medium, which it might be, I can't really tell, then that will help. Not bad. So then you should be able to apply Halo of Spores now with a high chance of success. Very nice. And you have a high hit chance. You're probably a good option for attacking this person who has the really, really high armor class anyway. Yeah, we probably do want pretty soon to switch to actually having... Oh, not what I meant to do. Switch to actually having your shield back, though. We'll throw the returning pike one last time, and then we probably better... Oh! Well. That spoils a plan to give that kill to the right person, but I mean, the rest of them should be pretty easy from here.
This is gonna feel good.
This is what, about 11 damage on average, whereas if I throw something, it does, you know, 5 plus its damage. Yeah, it's probably a little bit better than the Firebolt, roughly. Given they both have an equal-ish hit chance now.
Time to kill.
Okay, well, we've got Ballista to bring things in, I think. Pretty well done there, I think. So what's going to follow is just kind of several one-by-one little mini-fights against various enemies around here. They aren't really in position to cooperate with one another at all. Oh, well, let me equip that. Put it back into your inventory, then. I tried different things on like a test to see if there's any way to pull them into the one big fight here in Grimforge so I can get like the hardest possible fight. But there really doesn't seem to be. It seems like no matter what you do, you can only really fight these guys out here in their little individual groups, so they're not really much of a threat. Which might just kind of be an okay way to teach you about the enemies in the area and so forth, so you can, you know, fight them in little squads and then fight the big group after that, which is solid game design if so. Well, what weapon do I want to give to you? We can give you maybe... Where's Melf's first staff? That's pretty good for you. There, I mean, that's Krillin's Grace, okay. Melf's first staff. I know I've got it here somewhere. There it is. That would be a solid choice. Or Fowler or Lewis, I'm just ready to activate that at will. I'll probably go with the staff, though.
Find it here.
Oh, yeah, she was shouting to hear the echo. That'd be also while I'm thinking about it. Switch up Korlak's spells to have Lightning Bolt again instead of Fireball, now that in this area we're... Yeah, the enemies aren't weak to fire anymore. So looting that guy, Smoke Powder Bomb, is nice to have. He has this totally unique longsword here called the King's Knife. It's nothing special, it's just a longsword, but it looks neat. So, cool touch there, I think, to give the unique weapon to these guys. Okay, I guess she did have heavy armor, so that explains why the dexterity penalty did not actually affect her.
Moving in.
This section here about one of the mushrooms running away indicates that basically Glut abandoned his people and fled, so he calls Spaw a coward, but he just left his people to die and just ran to save himself, so he's probably more of a coward. Except insofar as, like, they don't seem to actually have brains other than what their sovereigns tell them half the time, so, I mean, if that's the case, who cares? A man told Dareth is an unimportant little underdark trading post, basically. Nothing too special as far as I'm aware. Thrin is kind of leading the digging group we'll be meeting here. And basically it seems like both the Rotte and the slaves are eating pretty poorly. Although presumably they left the rotten stuff in the barrel so as to not feed it to the slaves, because you wouldn't want to feed your slaves rotten stuff or they'll be sick and not be able to work. Well, over here we can have an interesting conversation with this guy's spiders and convince him to flee, which is fairly funny, I think. But, of course, I won't have the hardest fight, so I won't do things that way.
Dead drop.
Red-eyed bastard. Hey, wait a second. Absolute must have took you in.
So half the dwarves are with the Absolute. What do you have to buy or sell? Okay. Oh yeah, he often drops this thing. I remember that now. Huh.
Me? Who else? My spiders sussed them out of hiding, then near taught them a thing or two, and I let them fly.
Well, who cares about some drow? But we'll find out that they're with the Harpers.
Easy, Margs. Had the stench of the Toplands. Hung them here as a warning. Ain't no one drugs with Clan Flameshade.
I speak true, brothers. You know.
So she's trying to convince him to follow Lolth instead.
We need no Lolth, no Spider Queen. Father Mirmuth is the head of Clan Lurt.
So this is the loyalist.
Raised us, feeds us.
What care we for his business here? He keeps us small, keeps us contained. We should be with the Spider Queen, revered. adored.
He actually beat them in initiative. That's unfortunate for us.
I'm ready.
Well, if you just shoot down one of the spiders, that should then give you invisibility with which to attack him. And almost certainly hit him, of course. Yeah, that's pretty good. I don't know why you went into melee for that, but okay. Did I misclick in order to do melee without noticing? Maybe. ...65% is not as good. Can I do anything to lower that and make him more vulnerable? I can just throw something at you. This will say that it'll do 1223 damage, but it won't actually apply the radiant. It's a lie. You're probably not the right person to do that because you have terrible accuracy.
My little trick.
Okay, if you get a hit now, does that kill? Yes. Okay, so down goes that one. Now I've got another action, and now the rest of the spiders are pretty easy to clear up. I mean, they're not gonna be that hard anyway, but really easy now.
Never a dull moment.
Okay. Worth a shocking amount of XP considering how weak they are, because again, there's no real correlation between enemy strength and XP value. It's just kind of later game areas are worth more XP no matter how easy.
What's in here? Wonder if the gods are.
Let's have Lazelle pick up the Shining Saber of Skulls again for when we next want it. His hair tonic, as far as I'm aware, is useless, but it's worth a 10-to-1 ratio, so we're taking it. I think we can speak with one of the dead there it is, yeah, okay.
And, well, in it.
It's the Harper pin.
What an odd emblem. Don't think I've seen it before.
So, this I think is from Jahira, who's waiting in Last Light Inn. Let's speak with Dead and get a bit of a lore here.
The corpse regards you lifelessly.
Name's Jahira?
Jahira's.
I feel like we should all know the name Jahira, probably.
Hi, Harper, Jahira.
Karlak does, so that makes perfect sense. I guess maybe Lazelle shouldn't know, but the rest of us should definitely know Jahira.
Last Light.
Good information for us to have in character here. I like that they start setting things up for Act 2 here in Act 1, of course. That's just good writing.
God!
He was hoping for more details to maybe find out what their tactical advantages are so we can counter them, but of course we won't get that. So, two more dwarf encounters. These guys are kicking some bodies into the water over there. We want something, one of them has a treasure, actually.
You got a brain of your own. Use it.
And then up here, there are some ones near this poison barrel, or not yet poison barrel, a barrel we can poison that'll then kill these dwarf ones next time they get a drink. But we'll go over here to the ones throwing the bodies before they actually do that. If you get close, I start pushing them overboard, and eventually you can't get the one with the treasure, so it's best to get them now, I think, rather than risk that triggering prematurely. Stop right there.
Unless you're here to kick some stiffs lakeside, I suggest you bugger off.
That one seems to be handicapped in some way mentally and just can't really talk sense.
You gotta be kidding. These trash don't have nothing on them but rocks.
Rocks.
At ease. Observe and learn.
That's what we're doing here.
Assured victory, then you strike.
Any of them different in armor class? You've got a 12. Okay, yeah. A lot of the rogue have pretty bad armor classes, but really high hit points. So advantage matters less against them, but at least it's easy to apply, which is nice. Well, I guess, as usual, the best order... I don't know if they're using... If they have only 12 armor class, they're probably not wearing heavy armor. So probably hitting them with him to lower their dexterity will lower their armor class by at least 1 point. So it's technically advantageous then to do that first. Yep. So, every little advantage is worth something. Who's got the best... Okay, you have decent constitution. You've got better constitution. So you're the one to go for then with... Lazel's ability.
Victory awaits.
I might be over-optimizing these pretty easy fights, but I want to just make sure they have every resource I have available to me as I get into the later sections of Grimforge.
I am fury. I am death.
I won't give in.
On average, he can now get the kill pretty easily. Pretty good damage there. I should start doing Hex again more often, I think. Now that I'm in this area. Well, I guess I'm gonna travel out of here or lose it again, though, so maybe not. Doesn't make a big, big difference. Okay. We have saved all the corpses, so we can loot them.
I've got a long road ahead.
Another smoke powder bomb. You actually have a big collection of those. If they just cooperated to destroy the rubble that Nier is buried behind, they could have just solved the whole problem themselves.
Deep gnomes killed under the yoke of slavers.
You think dwarves of all people would be greedy enough to keep their slaves alive? Okay, that one truly has nothing. But at least one of them... Yeah, there we go. So this is a ring that gives you invisibility, which... Decent, I guess. Kalarduran Smooth Hands is one of the gods of the Deep Gnomes, I believe. Who has an open ring slot? I mean, poison resistance isn't that good, so you could arguably use it to sneak attack people, which is worth something to surprise them. This is also not really worth anything because electric damage is so, so rare. You have two ways to turn yourself invisible. I should probably actually get some use out of that one of these days. So maybe we'll give it to Carlex. We have two guys who can start fights by being invisible.
Mind never quiet.
This is a very apropos book to the subject. So it's about, you know, deep gnome slave, working for Dwergar slavers. That's pretty common, and Dwergar have always been slavers, basically. You need me to wipe your ass while I'm at it. Or drink less bad chat. Idiot Dwergar don't get it, apparently. Well, there's a passageway onward here that we could follow, but I think we'll do that later on for in-character reasons. Right now, we're just kind of clearing out the Dwerger here while they're all isolated. which just makes sense to do in character, I would say. We'll come back to the spoiler section in more detail soon. Again, if there's a way to get this as joined into the big fight, I would do that, but as far as I can tell, there just isn't one.
What I said! Stick shit! Another stick shit!
Piss pot.
You flirt. Now jump to it. Or it's up to the lift, straight to the shadows.
Now that's how you motivate the staff.
Again, Asarion loves it when people are slavers or treat slaves badly, even though he was a slave himself. He just has no empathy and no sympathy for anyone else.
Hold out your hands, Hoon.
You heard the man. Let's see him.
Scout all you want. You got 5 working fingers.
Perfect. Yeah, but I'm not one of you guys.
You claw him out. My drinking hand's busy. And he'll appreciate how few shits I have to give you. Hey! Stick shit! Where's my drink?
Coming right up, piss pot.
Stick shit talks like smug, and he wrecked that shroom village.
And then shagged it.
Here's to smug, nasty prick.
As I said, it seems to be just like an accent of the dwarf that they're always just speaking in vulgarities, like, all the time for some reason. I don't know why, because that was never mentioned in their lore before that I'm aware of.
My side? I heard the piss pot. You're a true soul.
And I guess we're speaking loudly about this right in front of them, but that's just how things go in this game all the time.
Fuller was mad as a rutting badger, but she weren't a friend of any true soul. What about piss off, do you? Hold on. You aren't just talking shit, are you? Then shh.
Yeah, good point. We shouldn't be having this conversation here.
Then hear you. Now, why in the hottest hells would a true soul be helping me? Fine. Let's say I believe you. You want to kill these peckers? I'm not complaining. But you better finish the job, because I'll be the one to suffer if you don't. Ain't you hearing me, prickhole? Piss off to every last hell.
Very convincing. Well, seems there's not really much to do here, so I'll just turn on... be able to push them off of the cliff to do a bit more damage, and push them off the cliff and start a fight that way. That didn't start a fight? What? Stealth? What? Okay. There we go. That was weird. But who's got the better armor class? You've got a 12, you've got a 13. You know, it's odd they don't have that drunk debuff that people have, but I guess they're dwarves, so... they have livers of steel.
Blood comes easy.
I guess I got my action back. It took them so long to even notice that we were fighting, apparently.
Time to strike. Taking position.
No, not high enough help to get any extra gravity damage, but still. I'm just tackling this fight the quick way, I think, because I'm not too worried about them. They're even weaker than the previous group were.
Got this.
Okay. Should now be pretty feasible for me to just take one out. Oh, if I could see them. Take one out like so. Path's interrupted. Is it interrupted or not? It's highlighted in blue. Okay, there we go. There we go. Let's just have you fire a shot that'll finish him off. Okay.
Still alive. So that's progress.
So he'll come back up here and be amazed.
Shit. What now? I know a place. Cross the lake.
I have no idea how he'll get back across the lake on his own, but apparently, it works.
Poison. Now that you've offed the pricks,
get you.
We could have put that into the drinks to instant kill them, which would have been, you know, pretty funny.
I won't forget it.
No, we can't rest, Korlak. Never rest.
They should all be running.
What's inside?
Here's his drinking journal, I think. So they have dreams about mind flayers and whatnot, because I guess they were actually, you know, have parasites or something like that, perhaps. Or maybe, you know, the clan elder is right, and they just somehow have some kind of racial memory of what happened to them before. It might be the psychic connection, that is, from the people who were infected without knowing it, basically, in the clan. But it doesn't really matter. So, up here, this is probably a pretty good place to end things. Before we talk to our friendly merchant here, meet the people who are trying to dig out near, and the pathway really branches out into this really great, interesting area. Alright, should be more challenging next time. We had a few good fights this time, though, I would say. I really love the one on the boat. Thank you for watching, everyone, and a special thank you to my Patreon supporters. Macy3131, Frank Maidens, MasterKnightDH, Jackie, and Lino, George Grin, Travis, CarloAndrea97, Cthulhu's Mom, Andrew Curzon, Troubzy, Gregory, William Wakefield, Danny Hall, Jeffrey Morse, Just Becca, Jack, Austin Livingston, Mashas01, Jacob Marshall, Nubiana, Till Fisher, Latinx Discord Colossus, Nicholas Schmuck, Kostya Nisterovich, Luke, Frederick Bruin, Goman Blackrock, Dodo King 4, Marcin Bialik, Maveth, Techno Waffle, Nebular, I Loop, Michael Francis, Emperor Kong 420, Robert Mackey, Micken Balls, Daniel Seta Chicago, Stilton Flamey, Micah Murray, Lloyd, Shang Chen, Christopher Allen, Stefan Van Zyl, Eddie, Kaimu, Wendy, and Ali Kasamoglu. Have a great day, everyone.